a line that is drawn through the ages. On that line stands an old rugged cross. On that cross, a battle is raging. A game of a man's soul or his loss. On one side march the forces of evil. All the demons and all the devils of hell. But on the other, the angels of glory. And they meet on Golgotha's hill. The earth shakes with the force of the conflict, and the sun refuses to shine. For there hangs God's Son in the balance, and then
hi, and welcome to today's podcast of It Is Finished with your host, Dr. and Evangelist K.O. Rich. Thanks for tuning in today. Today is Sunday, September the 15th of 2024. I pray that you have had a blessed and wonderful week last week, and that this week will continue to be blessed for you as well. Before we go on with today's podcast, I would like to invite you to visit us on our website at www.itisfinished.com. Again, that website address is www.itisfinished.com, and on the website you can listen to previous ministry podcasts, as well as get books for your entire family, church, and a Christian organization. And you can also click on the blog tab and read the Ezekiel lessons that I have posted throughout this year that we've been on this series. Again, the website address is www.itisfinished.com, and real soon I will have the .net and .org. And if you go on the website, you're going to see that it's been redone. There's some new things. Also, I've put on the Veterans in Christ, because we're going to start that podcast in October. So that's going to be every Tuesday and every Friday. Now, I'm trying to decide exactly what time is going to air, and I believe I'm going to have that at 10 a.m. However, you will be able to listen at the time of your choice, and that way it will always be in the archive. So that's Veterans in Christ podcast. You can go to that website and with It Is Finished and get more listen in once that's aired. And we also have a couple of podcasts that we did with the Veterans in Christ earlier. And with that one, I'm excited about that one, in addition to It Is Finished, because we are going to be talking to veterans and military families, active duty, reservists. We're going to be talking about benefits. We're also going to be talking about things for spiritually, whether you're dealing with PTSD, there's a lot of suicide with veterans, active duty, transitioning, family life can cause stress on the families. We're going to talk about a lot of different things on there. And so I'm excited about you being able to go along with me on this journey. So if you're active duty, if you're a veteran, if you're a reservist, any form of military, and even those civil servants, we're going to be talking for you too. So that's going to be the Veterans in Christ podcast, and that's going to be starting back in October. It's going to be every Tuesday, every Thursday at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 a.m. Central, or you'll be able to tune in at the time of your choice. As for It Is Finished, we're here every Wednesday and every Sunday at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, 9 a.m. Central. And so you can tune in, or you can go to the archives and listen to us from there. And I'm trying to think if there's anything else. Again, we have redone the website, so you will notice some changes that's on the website. Some things are still the same, but you'll notice it has a different look and different things that we're going to be adding more things on to the website. Also, please keep in prayer your Pakistani Christians. I'm teaching them every Thursday, so this has been, I think it's been about 4 months or maybe more, but we've been teaching every Thursday, Pakistani Christians. This week we're doing a conference, a two-day conference, for singles and couples. So the first day I'll be teaching the singles, and then the second day I'll be teaching couples. So please pray for me, pray for them, pray for the evangelist there, Evangelist Sashan. And Pakistan is there's a lot of Muslim. It's a Muslim nation. However, there are Christians there, and so we want to keep them in prayer, and we want to keep all our fellow brothers and sisters in prayer throughout the world. There's so much that's going on, and we are living in some serious times. Even here in the United States, there's things that's going on, and so just keep everyone in prayer. We know that Jesus is soon to return. We don't know the day. We don't know the hour, but we know that he is returning. And so we just want to stay at a state of preparedness. So this morning, let us just open up with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father God, we just thank you, God, for allowing us to come before your presence this morning, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all that you've done and all that you're doing in the lives of your people today, Lord. I ask you, Lord, to forgive us for all our sins. Please cleanse us from all unrighteousness, Lord. Lord, we want to thank you just for the things that you have done for us. We want to thank you for your goodness, Lord. You are so good. You're so gracious. You're so loving. You're so merciful, Lord. And we just want to thank you today, Lord. And Lord, we ask that you would be with your people all around the world. We ask, Lord, that you would protect and provide for those that are going through persecution in various places of the world. Be with them, guide them, deliver them, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Help them to know that you are there even in the midst of their storm, Lord. We ask, Lord, that you would be with those that are around the world, Lord, those that have diagnosis, Lord, that are the doctors say that they can't do anymore. We ask that you would be with them, Lord. We ask for healing in the name of Jesus. We ask that you would be with those, Lord, that are going through loss right now, that may be grieving the loss of a loved one, Lord. We know that you are near the brokenhearted, Lord, and you will never leave nor forsake them. And so, Lord, I ask that you would be with them, Lord, and even when they're going through the different stages of grief, Lord, we ask, Lord, that you would give them comfort in their hour of need, Lord. We pray for those, Lord, that are parents right now, Lord. And we ask that you would be with the guardians, Lord, of children, Lord. We pray for the children, Lord. There's so many school shootings and different things that's taking place, Lord. So many things that the devil is trying to tempt them with, Lord. But we ask, Lord, that you will cover the children today in the name of Jesus, inside and outside of the womb, Lord. Because we know that you are a God of life. And regardless of who says what, Lord, life begins at the moment of conception, Lord. And you are the God of life, and anyone want to take that away, rather in the form of appeal or on the table, Lord, we ask, Lord, that you will intervene in their behalf, and Lord, we ask that you will protect life, Lord, and help those that do not understand to know that all lives matter to you, Lord. Lord, we ask, Lord, right now, Lord, that you will be with those that are in the military right now, Lord. We ask that you will be with them, guide them, deliver them, Lord. We ask that you will be with your body, the body of Christ, Lord. We ask, Lord, that we will represent you well and that we will be ambassadors for you, Lord. Lord, there's so many things and so many needs right now, Lord, but we just ask, Lord, that you will meet each person, every need that they have, Lord, spiritually, financially, physically, Lord. Meet all of our needs, Lord, in the name of Jesus, Lord. We just thank you also for what you have already done, and we claim and proclaim the things that you're going to do, because you are God Almighty. You are Jesus, our King of Kings, our Lord of Lords. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for residing on the inside of us, Lord, and we ask that the oil will overflow to others. We ask all these things, Lord, in your Son's name, Jesus, Yeshua HaMashiach. Thank God. Amen. 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 I pray that you all are having a blessed and wonderful Sunday so far, and that the remainder of this week will continue to be blessed for you as well. This is not going to be a long podcast today. I do apologize. My dog is barking. I do apologize for that. But this is not going to be a long podcast today. This is going to be a podcast that's dealing with Ezekiel 40. Ezekiel 40. All right. Okay, I just had to pause it for a moment because my dog was barking. I do apologize for that. Anyway, we are going to start today on Ezekiel chapter 40. But we are not going through the whole chapter. I will allow you to go through that whole chapter and read it. We're going to take select verses from this particular chapter. And you're going to see a lot of different, as you read, a lot of different measurements for the temple area being restored. And how many of you know that sometimes we need our temple, our bodies, the temple of God to be restored? And so we know that Israel had gone into captivity. Judah had gone into captivity. Israel had gone into captivity with the Assyrians 140 years before Israel had gone, and before Judah had gone. And then Judah wound up going into captivity. And why were they in captivity? Because of their disobedience, because they had defied God, because they did not want to honor God, because they did not want to acknowledge God. And so therefore God allowed them to be judged. And so we are seeing here where Ezekiel is in this vision, and he's having a vision about the temple being restored. And so we're going to just go through a few verses today. As I mentioned, we're not going to be on here long today. But in Ezekiel chapter 40, verses 1 through 2, Ezekiel chapter 40, verses 1 through 2, and it says, in the 25th year of our exile, at the beginning of the year, the 10th of the month, in the 14th year after the fall of the city, on that very day, the hand of the Lord was on me, and he took me there in visions of God. He took me to the land of Israel and set me on a high mountain on whose south side were some buildings that looked like a city. And so we're seeing here that this was Ezekiel had been in exile for 25 years along with the other exiles. So according to historians, this would have been around 573 BC. This was the 10th day in preparation for the Passover. And we know that the celebration of the Passover was from when God rescued the children of Israel out of Egypt. But before they left, they were to put blood on the doorpost. And so therefore, when the blood was on the doorpost, then the death angel knew to pass by, to pass over. So that's where Passover began. And so we see here that the city, this city that Ezekiel is seeing after the fall of the city, is meaning after the fall of Jerusalem, after the fall of Judah. All right, so Judah had gone into captivity. We know that God had warned time and time and time again. He had sent his prophets. He had warned, and they did not listen. From the king all the way down was not subservient to the Lord, and so therefore God allowed them to be taken into captivity because they were doing sins that was more wicked than the nations before them. So therefore, this is the after effect. This was Ezekiel being taken when the city had been in ruins. Remember, Ezekiel was in Babylon, so he's having this vision in Jerusalem or of Jerusalem. And so therefore, I want to go to Ezekiel chapter 40, and we're still in 40, in verses 3 through 4. And it says, "He took me there, and I saw a man whose appearance was like bronze. He was standing in the gateway with a linen cord and a measuring rod in his hand. The man said to me, 'Son of man, look carefully and listen closely and pay attention. I am going to show to what I am going to show you, for what that is why you are brought here. Tell the people of Israel everything you have seen.'" And so this angel was giving him details about the temple that was going to be restored. And one thing that we know about God is a God of restoration. Yes, he is. He's a God of restoration. And so we see here that Judah had defied him, but God wanted to restore them. And people often look, when we talk about judgment, they look at, oh, well, it's doom and gloom. But see, God allows judgment for restoration. Come on now. He allows judgment for restoration. He wants us to check ourselves. He wants us to realign ourselves with him. He wants us to correct ourselves. Okay, so the judgment is not just because God is a God that wants to just punish us. No, God wants us to be corrected. He wants to have us to have our absolute best in him, but that's only in accordance with being in alignment with him. So when we talk about the temple being restored, that meant that it had fallen. Okay, we earlier on in Ezekiel, we talked about Ichabod. We talked about the glory departing. Okay, so the glory had departed the temple that was in Jerusalem. Why? Because God was not going to reside in a temple where it had been defiled. There were a lot of things that was going on, and so in order for the temple to be restored, it had to be torn down. And there are a lot of things in our lives that need to be torn down. We know that our bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. So whatever it is that is defiling us, then we have to allow it to be torn down so that God can do a restore. He can do a system reboot. Right now, I have one of my laptops at the shop, and they're having to restore it. Okay, it was acting up. The keys weren't working right. It wasn't going to the sites the way it should have. And so I had to go. I had to take it to someone who can go inside and fix it, who could restore it back to optimum level, and not just where it was. They're gonna add some what you call it? I'm not a computer geek or a whiz or whatever, but terabyte. Yeah, I think it's a terabyte if I'm correct. And they're gonna add some more memory so that it's not just restored, but it's better than it was before. before. And so we want to be better than we were before. We don't want to be the same person that we used to be. We don't want to be the same person that defied God. We don't want to be out of alignment with God. And so we need God to restore us. Come on now. Amen. We want him to fix us. We want him to make us anew. We want him to prune us. We want him to shape us. We want him to get out those things that are not like him in our mind, in our hearts, and our spirit being. We want to be Holy Spirit filled individuals. And so God was restoring this. This is what Ezekiel was seeing, the measurements. Now some scholars they say that this restoration was not going to be during that particular time. So they were saying that even this was not the measurement regarding the temple at that time that was being restored. Some scholars say that this is the millennium. We know that that Jesus, we're going to reign with him for 1,000 years. And so, but regardless of rather it was that temple then or a future temple, because we do know that a third temple is coming even in Jerusalem. And we know that this was in the book of Revelation when John was told to measure, but not measure the outer courts or whatever. And so that's in the book of Revelation. But the thing is that it's meaning the spiritual. We could take this even meaning spiritually, the restoration of Israel. God wanted them to be restored. He wanted them to come back to him. He wanted them to follow him. And so during the time of Ezra, when Israel had come back, they had to clean up some things. They had to get rid of some things. They even had to get rid of some of their wives that they had married that were foreign wives, because if they hadn't, then the same thing that got them in that condition to begin with was going to continue. See, when you have, for example, anyone that may have had cancer, you know that, hey, they try to go in, and if they say that they can do surgery, they try to take it all out. They don't want to leave any of it there because it can come back and infect the rest of the body or whatever. So they want to take it all out. We want God, when God is restoring our temples, we want him to take everything out. We don't want him to leave anything there that's not of him. That means sometimes we have to change our thought process, okay? We have to change what comes out of our mouth. We have to change what goes in. We have to change our eyes. We have to change what we allow to hear. We have to change what even the people that we are around, if they're taking you away from God, then that means that, hey, I love you, but I'm going to have to love you at a distance because you are detrimental to my spiritual health, and I need my temple to be restored. Come on now. I need my temple to be where the Holy Spirit can reign and the oil can overflow. Come on now. I need God to be able to reside on the inside of me. I need Jesus to feel as if that he is the priest. He needs to be the priest of my life. And therefore, I need my temple restored. Say with me, I need my temple restored. I need a restoration. And that restoration can only come from God. It's not going to come from alcohol. It's not going to come from drinking. It's not going to come from drugs. It's not going to come from partying. It's not going to come from gambling. It can only be, your temple can only be restored through the Lord. And so in this vision, Ezekiel was seeing the restoration. He was seeing the measurements. He was seeing the east gate and the outer courts. He was seeing the north gate and the south gate. He was seeing the gates to the inner court. He was seeing all these things, and they were being measured. Why? Because God is a God of precision. Come on now. And sometimes when God is restoring us, he does things in stages. I'm going to take this away. I'm going to add this. I'm going to do this. I'm going to align her this way. I'm going to align him that way. He's very precise. God's timing is the ultimate timing. His timing is the good timing. His timing is the wise timing. Sometimes we want God to do things in our lives, but we're not ready for it. Come on now. We're not mature enough for it. And so therefore, God is about precision. So even when we see him saying 50 cubits and 25 cubits and 5 cubits and measure the south and measure the north and have it facing this way and have it facing that way, God is a God of precision. And he is like that even in our temples, in our lives. He is a God of precision. And oftentimes we may ask, well, God, will you do X, Y, and Z for me? And God is saying, no, you're not ready yet. I need to do some more pruning with you. So I got to align you right. You're not ready in 2000, but you're ready in 2024. You were not ready in 2015, but you're going to be ready in 2024. I got to make sure that the timing is right. I got to make sure that the people around you are right. I got to make sure that your head is right. I got to make sure that you're in a posture of prayer. I got to make sure that everything is aligned in the way that it's supposed to be. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be back in just a moment. Presence of the Lord is here. Presence of the Lord is here. I feel it in the atmosphere. Presence of the Lord is here. Oh, presence of the Lord is here. Spirit of the Lord is here. Anybody feel it tonight? Feel it in the atmosphere. The Spirit of the Lord. Right, the presence of the Lord is here, and that is by Byron Cage. I can feel the presence of the Lord, and I'm going to get my, I'm going to get my blessings right now. But the presence of the Lord is here, and that's the most important thing, is the presence. We want the presence of the Lord in our midst. And this is something that Israel did not understand, that they were nothing without God. They were nothing without God. And we too, we are nothing without God. There's a lot of things that's going on. And again, this is going to be a shorter podcast, so I'm not going to hold you all that much longer. But this, there has been so much that's going on. We know that we've had individuals just shooting people at random. We had recently another school shooting. We have things that's going on in Israel, where all the nations are coming against Israel. And we talked recently about Ezekiel 38 and Ezekiel 39 with regards to those countries, including Russia. Okay, Magog and Gog and Magog. We're seeing Bible prophecy be fulfilled. And the sad thing is, many people think that, that's going to change everything. Bible prophecy is going to be put on hold, and it's going to change everything, that the Bible is not going to be fulfilled. But let me just say this, regardless of who gets in office, the Bible will be fulfilled. You have candidates that's advocating for abortion. And let me just say this, because one of the reasons we're going to be judged as a nation, and we're being judged with the things that we're seeing right now, is judgment, is because we have killed 60 million children. When I say we, I'm talking about our votes. You might say, well, you know, I've never had an abortion. I haven't either. But the thing is that with our votes, we have voted people in that was for this. We have voted ungodly. Our tax dollars are going towards this stuff. And we're regardless of which candidate, let me just say this. You have one that is, I guess, all the way to late term abortion. And then you have one that says, oh, I'm okay with the pill, the abortion pill. Life begins at the moment of conception. And as Christians, it is our job to align our lives, our votes, whatever we do, we're to align ourselves in the will of God. You don't get to, I'm going to turn it on and turn it off. That means that everything we do, including your vote, that means that you have to do it in accordance with the will of God. So some may say, well, I'm choosing the lesser of the two evils. Evil is still evil when it's going to result you in hell. Come on now. There's not a little bit of evil here and a little bit of evil there. Well, what are we supposed to do? You better pray about that. You know, you better pray about that. Because when you have both parties, that one might take it to the extreme and the other one is a little less extreme, it's still wrong in the eyes of God. We have parties that both are, where one is way out for LGBTQ plus, whatever you want to call it. And then the other one, well, you know, they're not as not as promoting it, but still will not go against it. It's still wrong. It's still sin. You can't say this is a little bit of sin here and a little bit. You put some arsenic in some water, regardless of how much you put in, it's still poison. All right. So we're living where there are no righteous leaders, and some might be, I'm not saying that everyone is corrupt, but we're living in a wicked nation. We have a wicked government, a wicked nation. And when we have a wicked nation, God allows us to have wicked leaders. The reason we're seeing all these things take place where foreigners are coming in, and I know they lied and said that they're not eating cats and dogs and geese and all this kind of stuff. But let me just say this, go on your social media, do your research, okay? There's eyewitnesses, there's police that have seen this, put the person and people in jail because this is taking place. Guard your cats, watch your house, watch your cats, first of all, watch your life with regards to your spiritual walk with God. We haven't seen anything yet. We think that, oh, well, it's getting worse. You know, you have politicians that lie and lie and lie. And people think, oh, well, we're going to change and we're going to make America great again. There is no greatness without God. You can't vote your way to righteousness. You can't vote your way out of Bible prophecy. And we're seeing things that's taking place that we have never seen before. We're seeing that food, for example, is costing more. How did God punish Israel and Judah? Famine. Okay, you won't be able to even afford food. Plagues. They're talking about monkeypox and more COVID things and different things that's coming over here. They're predicting that there's going to be some other things that's taking place. Why? Because man-made. There's a contamination with the meats and the food, okay? Even the vegetables. You're seeing where how they got punished them in their economics, okay? We're seeing that everything is rising. It's not getting better. It's rising. Gas prices, double what they were 4 years ago. Food, 25%, if not higher, more than it was ago. People are working more and getting less, paying more and getting less. We are living in the last days where people are killing each other. They don't care. And people, I'm voting for this person because they're black. I'm voting for this person because they're white. I'm voting for this person because of their economics. When are we going to understand the times in which we're living in? Be like Issachar and be know the seasons, know the times, understand that, you know what? The days of America's greatness, the other nations know, but we don't know. Isn't that funny? The other nations know that we're falling, but we seem to not know. The church should know. The church should be preparing you. The church should be saying, hey, you know, get your house in order. Things are about to change. We're living in the last days. Jesus is coming. You hardly ever hear even any sermons that Jesus is coming again, that Jesus is returning, that Jesus wants us to get our house in order, that we are living in the last days, that we need to be prepared, that persecution is taking place in many countries and will take place here. Many don't want to say that because they want you to be in this euphoria that, oh, we're going to be okay just right where we are. And God, let me just say this, God does protect his own and God does bless his own. But remember, we're studying the book of Ezekiel, and even Ezekiel was in exile. However, God still had his hand on him. And that's what we want. We want our temples to be restored. And wherever our physical bodies are, we are still in the Lord. And yet we need to still sound the alarm and let the people know that God is displeased with this nation and around the world. But the church will be judged first, the house of God, and this nation is being judged. The reason we're seeing things happening and with more to come is because this nation, America, is under judgment. And no politician can change that. God wants repentance. Repent, for the day of the Lord is near. If you have not accepted Jesus into your heart today, I ask that you would say this prayer with me. Lord, I'm a sinner. Have mercy on me. Create in me a clean heart and renew the right spirit within me. I accept Jesus into my heart today. Fill me, cleanse me, make me anew. I accept you, Lord, as the Son of the living God. Have mercy on me. And if you said that prayer, then welcome to the body of Christ. God loves you. He cares for you. He sent his Son down here to die for you. And all you have to do is accept the free gift of salvation. It is free. It has already been paid for by the blood of the Lamb. It doesn't mean stay in your sins. It doesn't mean continue doing the things that you know defies God. It means allow him to change you from the inside out. Only he can do it. But you have to do your part too. God bless you. This is Dr. and Evangelist K.O. Rich with It Is Finished End Times Ministries, bringing you a word that you may not have heard as it relates to the Bible and end times. Until next time.